At the beginning of the previous chapter, I introduced to you that we'd have three ways of looking at bonding. We could look at Lewis theory, and then we could look at valence bond theory, and then we'll have a third called molecular orbital theory. So we're ready to start this discussion of valence bond theory. With Lewis theory, we can predict shapes of molecules, and we can learn some properties based upon the shapes. But valence bond theory is going to get in and look at things a little bit differently, but it will have a beginning point still being doing a Lewis structure. So it's taking a Lewis structure and taking it to the next step and really describing what those electrons are doing more so than what a Lewis structure will do. So this is what valence bond theory is all about. It is looking at how atomic orbitals overlap to form bonds, okay? It's an overlapping. So the Lewis structure doesn't help us account for some of the properties that we see in covalent bonds. We can just see it sharing a couple of electrons, and that's all we can see it as. We've got a pair of electrons being shared, we call that a bond, and that's the end all and the be all of that theory. When we start looking at the valence bond theory, it's going to be one of two, and like I said, we're going to look at molecular orbital theory as well, that is going to give a more accurate depiction of what those electrons are doing. It'll start taking into account the shapes that we know they have. We determined and practiced and learned about the shapes, but the bonding doesn't help us, in Lewis structure, doesn't help us see that why the shape would be the shape that it is. So, both methods use quantum mechanics. Both methods, down at their core, are very high and intense mathematical manipulations of these orbitals. Because remember, orbitals are nothing more than a mathematical representation of an area in space where you have a high probability of finding these electrons. So both the valence bond theory that we'll look at now and molecular orbital theory that we look at later do have as their basis these high calculus calculations that we won't do, of course, because calculus is not a prerequisite for this class. But you're going to have to just trust me a little bit, and I'm going to have to do a little bit of, you know, this is magic and this is what happens, and you have to realize there is an underlying reason for those things. So what is valence bond theory? What is the at the heart of it? Valence bond theory assumes that an electron in a bond is occupied, I got to have my hands to do this. We have an atomic orbital on this atom, and we have an atomic orbital on this atom, and they overlap and share space, okay? And that is what a bond is all about in valence bond theory. That is all it is, an overlapping of that. So I have to have an orbital over here that only has one electron in it, and an orbital over here that only has one electron on it, so that when they overlap and they share this space, there's that shared space that only has two electrons. So we still can only have two electrons in that space, just like we had in an atomic orbital by itself. Okay? So let's look at the simplest case. Let's look at the simplest case of forming the diatomic molecule hydrogen, H2. In H2, we know that one hydrogen atom has a, get my pen working here, has an electron in the 1s orbital. So here is a 1s orbital, and it has one electron in that 1s orbital. And I have another hydrogen atom that has 1s orbital, and it has the one electron buzzing around in this. If I could overlap those spaces, that would be what the bond is that makes H2, okay? So now, this is showing a potential energy map of that process. When they're really far apart, okay, we see that on the right-hand side of the screen, and as they move closer and closer, there is some point where we have a minimum energy. Minimizing energy is what always drives chemistry. We want to find the place in which we have got the least amount of potential energy. That is the stored energy within that bond. So there is some optimal distance between the nuclei, some optimal distance here between those nuclei where those electrons that will be the shared space Now, it's not just that the electrons will hang out here only. They will hang out anywhere in this space encompassing that area. And that minimum potential energy that we see in here is going to drive the bond length of this thing. If you push them any closer together, then we start getting an increase, rapid increase, because we start getting those nuclei way too close together, and those positive centers are not going to be happy with that. So there's some optimal distance of overlap that it will strive to obtain. So let's look at some statements here that I have. The bond forms because as those orbitals overlap, the potential energy is going to reach some minimum. And then what I said there before, if they get too close together, the potential energy is going to increase drastically. So it's not like it's great if it's a little close together, so it's got to be even better if they're closer. We have to have this optimal space. So the molecule, the system is going to be most stable wherever that minimum energy, whoops, I got that off of there, where that minimum energy is, okay? Every time two atoms come together and form a bond, it's going to, every time, form a bond by an atomic orbital on this atom and an atomic orbital on this atom, finding that minimum energy by overlapping their space and then sharing that space with the electrons that were in those those atomic orbitals. So an atomic orbital in this atom, an atomic orbital in this atom, find that minimum energy by getting close enough together so that they can share space and share the electrons in that space. And that's all valence bond theory is, except it always looks a little more complicated than that. Okay, so let's go to the next example. The next example is another diatomic molecule. It's HF. So if we wanted to describe the bonding of HF using valence bond theory, all we have to do is describe what atomic orbitals are overlapping. I'm going to say that again, because people think there's a lot of craziness about this, but that's all we're doing in valence bond theory. In valence bond theory, we are describing the bond by saying what atomic orbitals are overlapping to make that bond. Okay, so let's work on how we determine that. To decide, we need to look at which orbitals only have one electron in them. To figure that out, we ought to do the Lewis structure. I don't mean Lewis structure. What I mean is the electron configuration of them, okay? So if I did the electron configuration of hydrogen, it's 1s1. If I did the electron configuration of fluorine, it is, and you want to look at a periodic table to get this, it is helium 2s2, 2p5. Let's keep in mind what a 2p5 means. It means I have those three p orbitals and I go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I found my orbital that only had one electron in it. I've got this orbital that only has one electron in it, and I have this orbital that only has one electron in it. You need an orbital that only has one electron in it to overlap with another atomic orbital on a different atom that only has one electron on it. And once you find those are what overlap to form the bonds. So I have done the electron configuration of each of those. I have identified the orbitals that only have one electron in it, okay? And then I am going to make the bond, the overlap of those. So let me draw the 1s orbital of hydrogen. Let me draw a 2p orbital of fluorine. Remember what a p orbital looks like. There is the 2p orbital of fluorine. And all of this space is where those two electrons, this electron here and this electron here, are spending their time in this space. The nucleus of the hydrogen is here, the nucleus of the fluorine is here, and those two electrons are being able to spend any time in that space shared by that those overlapped orbitals. So they don't just hang out in this overlapped space, they can go anywhere in that space there, and that is the minimum potential energy, a certain distance that allows for the maximizing that overlap. So valence bond theory, let me one more time say it. Valence bond theory, when you describe a bond in valence bond theory, you always want to state what orbitals overlap. So now I'm ready to describe the bond in HF. So let's draw HF. We know H has a single bond between the H and the F. If I want to describe that single bond, I would use words like this. This bond is the overlap of the 1s orbital on hydrogen with a 2p orbital of fluorine. and I have now described that bond. Now, all of that would be a nice end of the story, but we have to realize that it can't stop there. And we're going to be looking at, it works for any diatomic molecule, all right? Every time you have a diatomic molecule, you're going to be able to use this kind of thing to describe the bond in it. But if you get more than two, then you're going to have to add a twist to it. And because there's going to need to be this little twist that I'm going to help you with that accounts for the bond angles that we know happen when we have these shapes. Now, when we did a Lewis structure, we were able to predict shapes. The valence bond theory is telling us why those shapes are the shapes that they are. So we're going to really examine very closely the molecule of CH4. And we're going to work our way through with CH4 this thing called hybridization, okay, or why it has to happen. So we're going to start with this. The electron configurations of CH4. Well, let's start with H. That's easy enough. There's the electron configuration of H. Let's do it for carbon. Carbon is helium, 2s2, 2p2. Okay, so what I have in my p orbitals, and I'll draw them out with my three little lines there, is I have two electrons. This one is all filled up. This one is all filled up. We wouldn't want to worry about inner shells anyway, because only valence shells can get involved in bonding. And it looks to me like I could only form two bonds. If I could only form two bonds, then CH4 could never exist. So something else is happening here. Let's talk about what's happening here. So we don't have four orbitals with only one electron. And so what happens at this point is to form four bonds, we have to do some promotion, okay? We'll talk about that as we go on. The electrons are actually going to spread out. So instead of, and let me do this in yellow instead of pink. Instead of what we see right here with the two electrons in the 2p and the three electrons in the 2p, I don't know if I said that right, so I'm going to say it again. I've got two electrons in the 2s and the two electrons, this is the 2s, the two electrons in the 2p. What's going to happen is I'm going to promote one of these up to here, and we're going to get some promotion going on here. So, you can't see that 2p, I can tell that right now. That's a 2, and that's a b. Okay, so now I have a 2p. These are my three 2p's. So I'm going to take this electron and promote it up to this 2p. So that's going to give me my 2s that only now has one electron in it. And there's the 2p's with their 1, 2, 3 electrons in it. So I've got four orbitals now with only one electron in it. Now, why would it want to promote up? It takes energy to do that, all right? It takes energy to take an electron out of a 2s and c. So don't think that this is not, you know, it doesn't cost it something. But why would it do that? The reason it takes that energy to promote it up is because every time it forms a bond, and I have four opportunities now to form a bond, every time it forms a bond, it lowers its potential energy. Remember that curve we looked at when we were looking at hydrogen where it had the dip, okay, and its potential energy, and we were trying to achieve that dip? We now have four opportunities to achieve a minimum energy. So a little cost to promote will give me lots more bonds. If I don't promote, I can only form two bonds. I can only drop the potential energy twofold. But if I have four, I can drop it fourfold. I can really bring in a lot of low potential energy. So valence bond theory, you have to have atomic orbitals with only one electron in it, and that's what forms the bond. But there are situations where you don't have enough orbitals with only one electrons in it, and if you're forming multiple bonds, it's got to be this happening. We have to have this promotion occurring. Okay, now, this is still not the only story. Let's look at this image here on the screen. If this were the only story, okay, then what we would see here is only 90 degree angles, because a p orbital, okay, are 90 degrees to other p orbitals. And when an s orbital overlaps with something, it would be different than if a p orbital overlaps with something. So what we see inside of here is the 2s orbital of carbon, okay? And this is a 2p orbital of carbon, and this is another 2p orbital of carbon. This right here can't be what's happening because we don't see 90 degrees. We don't see two different types of bonds in CH4, and we do not see bond angles that are 90 degrees. We know that we have bond angles of 109.5. So what we predicted when we were doing Lewis structures and the geometry was when you've got CH4, you've got four legs trying to get as far apart from each other as they possibly can go, and we know that it is absolutely a tetrahedron, not anything that looks like this guy here. So this is not what happens, but this is all we've got so far with valence bond theory. So there has to be more to it. The more to it that we're going to get to in our next lesson is the hybridization that's going to occur. It doesn't change the fact that valence bond theory is nothing more than an atomic orbital overlapping with an atomic orbital. But these atomic orbitals are going to go away. Actually, they're going to get mixed together. And when we mix them together, we form new atomic orbitals that we have never seen before. And we'll look at that in our next lesson.